Okay, class, our next section is going to be accelerated junctional rhythm and junctional tachycardia. When we learned about PJCs, we said premature beats were coming in because of irritability. We also learned about junctional escape, though, when the SA node didn't fire and the junction kicked in to throw in an extra beat to help out. Then we learned about our junctional rhythms themselves. The SA node fails to fire, the junction kicks in as a backup system. A backup system for the junction is at a rate of 40 to 60. When we're talking about accelerated junctional rhythms and junctional tachycardias, we're talking about when the junction becomes irritated and it takes over from the SA node, not because it's a backup system, but because there's irritation happening. Now, one of the things we learned is that whatever is the fastest rhythm, whatever has the fastest rate, that's what's going to pace the heart, which is normally the SA node because it normally fires at a rate of 40 to 60 beats. But if we're talking about something in the junction is taking over due to irritation, then that means that junction has to speed up and go faster than what the SA node would go at. So when we're talking about accelerated junctional rhythms and junctional tachycardias, we're saying the junction is taking over to pace the heart due to irritability. The junction fires faster than the 40 to 60 beats per minute it normally would, and it actually goes faster than what the SA node's firing at to override it. So if the rate is between 61 and 100, it is considered an accelerated junctional rhythm. If the rate is over 100, then it is a junctional tachycardia. Now, junctional tachycardias at faster rates may actually get lumped into that term we learned about SVTs, or supraventricular tachycardias, because when you have really fast tachycardias, whether it's hard to tell if it's coming from the sinus area, the atrial area, or the junction, because it's hard to see all the components when it starts going too fast. So this first example here, we're going to start learning about an accelerated junctional rhythm. And I can see here that my rhythm from QRS to QRS to QRS to QRS, it looks normal. It's regularly spaced. My rate is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I have an inverted P wave, and it looks like my PR interval. It's really hard to see these little boxes here, but it's almost three boxes. It's just shy of it. My QRS is a normal size. So this would be its junction. As with any junctional rhythm, you're going to have an inverted P wave with a short PR interval in lead 2, or you're going to have no P wave but a normal size QRS. So this is the classification of what a junctional is, but my rate is 70, which is going to make it an accelerated junctional rhythm. Now here's another example. It's showing it to you in two different leads, but if we look at this top one here, QRS to QRS to QRS to QRS is regular. My rate is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so rate is 70 again. Now on this one, I have no P wave in front of my QRS, but I have a normal size QRS. My QRS is less than 0.12. Looks like it's about 2.5 boxes. So this is going to make it junctional in origin. Now, one of the things we talked about before in the earlier classes is if you're not sure what something is, let's figure out what it isn't. We know this cannot be a sinus rhythm. I have no sinus P wave in front of it. Can it be atrial? I don't have an atypical P wave in front of it. Now, in atrial fib, we learned that we can have an indistinct P wave. Well, this is definitely an indistinct P wave, but in atrial fib, I would have an irregular R to R, and in this one, my QRS to QRS is normal. We haven't learned ventricular yet, but we'll learn with ventricular, we'd have a wide bizarre QRS. So the only thing that is left that this could possibly be is junctional in origin, but again, because my rate is between that 61 to 100, it's going to make it accelerated junctional rhythm. Here's another example. QRS to QRS to QRS to QRS looks normal. My rate is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, a rate of 80. I have no P wave in front of this QRS. I have a nice normal, narrow-looking QRS. Normal QRSs, normal-sized QRSs, look narrow as they're going across the screen. My QT interval looks like it's fine as well. So this is junction and origin, but again, because my rate is 80, it would be an accelerated junctional rhythm. So we can chart that AJR at 80. This example right here, it looks like, again, I have a regular rhythm. my rate would be 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So a rate of 100. So 100's normal. Over 100 becomes a tachycardia. No P wave in this example. QRS is a normal size. QT is a normal measurement. So it would be an accelerated junctional rhythm, or AJR, at 100. Now on this example here, though this looks like one that we've already sort of looked at here, looks like R to R to R is regular. Our rate here looks like it's a rate of 80. No P wave in front of it. Normal size QRS. Our QRS here looks like it's only about 0.06. My QT interval looks like it's about 8, maybe 8.5 boxes. It's normal. So this would make this an accelerated junctional rhythm at 80. This example down here on the bottom, QRS to QRS to QRS looks regular for my spacing. My rate is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so rate is 70. Looks like I have an inverted P wave, and it goes right into my QRS. And my PR interval looks like it's 1, 2, it's really close to 3. It's just shy of 3. QRS is a normal size measurement. T wave looks pretty flat. Well, actually, it looks like I have an inverted T wave after it. So this would make this an accelerated junctional rhythm at 70, I think I said. Now, when the rates go over 100, now it becomes a junctional tachycardia. So when I look at this one here, I'm looking at a regularly spaced rhythm. QRS to QRS to QRS is regularly spaced. My rate is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So my rate here is pretty fast. And I'm actually thinking it probably shouldn't have been this fast. It looks like maybe when I put it in my PowerPoint, it kind of skewed my reading here. But I can see I have an inverted or an upside down P wave, and then it goes directly into my QRS. So that's making it junctional, but because my rate is over 100, it's going to be a junctional tachycardia. Now this one here, I can still see the components. I can see an inverted P wave with a short PR interval. I can see I have a normal size QRS measurement. This one here, QRS to QRS to QRS to QRS is regular. My rate is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Let's say the last one falls in it because I need to make this a tachycardia. So we're going to say this was a three, this whole thing was a 6 second strip. So we are going to count this one, even though normally wouldn't fall in that one. So that would give it 110. I have an upside down P wave. I have an inverted P wave. My PR interval looks like it's about 2.5 boxes, which would make it 0.10, which is short. QRS size looks like it's about 2.5 boxes as well. So I would have a junctional tachycardia, or JT, at 110. Now this example here, QRS to QRS to QRS to QRS to QRS is regular. My rate is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, so 110. I have no P wave in front of this one, though. QRS is a normal size, possibly even a P wave here after it. It's a little hard to tell. And that's one of the problems of having a P wave after the QRS. Sometimes you can't tell if you have a P wave after it or if it's just kind of a funny ST and T wave change to it. But either way, I have no P wave in front of it and a normal size QRS, so that is going to make this junctional. So it'd be a junctional tachycardia at 110. Now, when the junctional tachycardias start getting really fast, so in this example here, I have R to R to R is regular. In this 3 seconds, I can tell my rate is about 80, and then it speeds up. My R to R still becomes regular, but in this rhythm, it is much faster. And remember when we talked about the term paroxysmal, when you see a sudden start or sudden stop of something or sudden burst of a rhythm. So it looks like what's happening is it looks like I'm in an accelerated junctional rhythm, no P wave, normal size QRS, and then I go into this fast rhythm. It's regular, R to R to R is regular. QRS doesn't change. Doesn't look like I have the P wave in front of it. So it looks like I'm going from an accelerated junctional rhythm into a junctional tachycardia. But when I look at this lower strip here, QRS to QRS to QRS is still a normal rhythm, or still normally spaced. If this is 3 seconds, my rate is 1, 2, 3. three, four, five, six, seven, so a rate of 140. And here I'm looking at this and I'm saying, okay, do I have no P wave or is that a P sitting with my T? I am not really sure. I can tell you I have a normal size QRS because my QRS measurement looks narrow to me just by eyeball. And when I measure it, it looks like it's about 1 to 2.5 boxes. So I have a regular R to R. I have a rate that's 140 and I'm looking at this saying, okay, do I have no P wave or do I have a P sitting with my T? I'm not sure, but I know this is supraventricular in origin because my QRS is a normal size. When you have a regular R to R to R and you have a normal size QRS, you know that the ventricles are getting the message through the normal pathways. So it is supraventricular in origin. And since I'm not sure exactly where above the ventricles it's coming for sure, is this an atrial P wave sitting on a T? Is it a sinus P wave sitting on top of a T? Do I not have a P wave? And this is a junctional. I do know it's a normal size QRS, so I'm going to call this a supraventricular tachycardia at 140. So remember, our SVTs are kind of a catch-all term for any tachycardia that's so fast we are just not 100% sure where it's coming from. This is an SVT, and I actually pulled it up out of a junctional tachycardia book, a 12 lead of it, but again, R to R to R is regular, and you're looking at this saying, okay, is there a P wave with this? Is there no P wave, or is that a P wave sitting with the T? It almost looks like no P wave to me, so I think I would tend to maybe want to call this a junctional tachycardia, but I could easily call this an SVT as well. It's that catch-all term. I know it's regularly spaced. I know my QRS is normal. Not 100% sure where it's coming from, so I can use that term supraventricular tachycardia. Sorry, I don't know what happened to my screen there. Okay, sorry for the minor technical difficulty, but causes of accelerated junctional rhythms and junctional tachycardias, heart attack patients, shock, possibly potassium disorders. Sometimes we see this with our pulmonary disease patients, our COPDers, ditch toxicity, stimulants, and even open heart surgery. The significance with an accelerated junctional rhythm, we very rarely have any symptoms. It's a normal rate. Our cardiac output really doesn't change. With junctional tachycardia, we may see palpitations and anxiety, so our cardiac outputs can drop if we have really fast rates. So we're always going to try to treat the cause if possible. What's making it junctional? That's what we need to look at. If our rate is really fast, if we have an SVT, we can do a vagal maneuver to try to slow it down. We can do calcium channel blockers or beta blockers or amiodarone. And if they're unstable, they're deteriorating quickly, their blood pressure is dropping quickly, we can do a cardioversion if needed. So that's going to end our junctional section.